So hi guys, Jonathan Graham here for Guitar Interactive magazine. We are here at Wembley with the one and only Steve Stevens. How are you doing today, buddy?
Great, yeah.
Now, before we started rolling there, we were just talking about this particular venue, because some places are just, every time you guys play a show, it's absolutely killing. You guys give it 110%, we know that. But some places are just that little bit more special sometimes than others. And Wembley is one of these venues similar to like a Madison Square Garden.
Absolutely.
How is it to be finally playing this place tonight?
I'm just putting myself into Billy's headspace to finally, after all these years, headline Wembley, which I'm sure that, you know, he probably came to shows here as a kid, as I did with Madison Square Garden. So I'm really proud of, you know, I'm proud of him and proud of, you know, the fact that here we are, you know, still working together 40 years later, new music,
yeah.
Great band. Band is really firing on all cylinders at this point. So it's you know, when the stars align and all of these elements are right, it's, you know, knock on wood.
Yeah,
should have a great show tonight.
Absolutely. Now, yeah. You know, it was a long time coming as fans. We couldn't wait to see these shows. Obviously, it got rescheduled there. It's finally happening now. Now that you guys are out of the cage, we'll talk about the cage in just a second, how is it to be taking this this show on the road again, finally?
Yeah, I mean, it's, there's that expression, you don't know what you have till it's gone. And I don't know if we ever took for granted being in front of an audience, but when it, you know, when COVID first hit, you know, no one really knew whether, what the you know, touring situation would be, or, you know, when we'd be, you know, able to resume shows and things like that. So we kind of dove into the, you know, what we could do. Okay, what can we do? We can continue to write songs. We can, you know, with quarantining, you know, we can continue to record.
Yeah.
We're pretty much, you know, as Billy and I have always worked together as a team, it's usually us and a producer, and it's a small contained entity, whereas you know, with a bigger band or whatever, you have more people to account for. So we kind of said, you know, we'll continue to do what we've always done: write songs, record music, be productive, and kept. I think it helped keep our sanity to a certain extent. So you know, and now that we are back on the road, number one, we're really grateful, and we've got a renewed vigor about it. And also, I get this feeling from the audience that they too are ready to, you know, celebrate, you know, something that, oh man, we you know, we haven't seen Billy Idol in, you know, however long, 2 years or whatever, and the reaction has just been, it's like shared celebration.
Oh, definitely, you know, yeah. And of course, with timing us just right as well, you know, number one in the rock charts with the new EP, and that tells you all you need to know about the appetite for the fans and loving the new music. Now, one thing is, you know, we just mentioned this just before we were rolling, but you guys taking this time off from playing, of course, the delays mean that because you guys are so prolific that we, as fans, we get to hear some more new stuff. Was that always the sort of the plan? Because obviously you guys, you're at a stage now, you never need to prove yourselves or whatever, but is it just that, the you know, such a great space at the moment that the new music is just coming and let's just put it out there?
Yeah, I think also that the business model has changed, because, you know, it used to be back in the day, you know, you'd spend, you know, 6 to 8 months recording the music, and then the machinery has to kick in, promotion, all this. And sometimes music that you recorded wouldn't get heard by your fans for a year later.
Yeah.
And the thought that, well, if we do, you know, batches of songs in fours, we can put them out as EPs, and literally within a month, songs that were recorded, or in some case 3 weeks, boom, it's out. It's released online. It's fresh. We're not tired of it. Mm. We're still excited about it. So I think that's, you know, that's been some, you know, a revelation to us, and I think we'll continue to do it that way.
Fantastic.
You know, get the music out quickly, and also, you know, there's a whole new generation of fantastic songwriters and musicians and producers that are, you know, maybe they grew up with some of the classic Billy Idol stuff, that want to, you know, want the opportunity to work with us and prove themselves, and show what they can bring to the table sonically. You know, I've wanted to work with Zach Cervini, who co-produced, and you know, I had my eye on him for a while because all of these records that I liked sonically, who did that? Zach Cervini, and then lo and behold, he's the guy we work with. So it's great, and I can't wait to see what happens in the future as well.
So are we already talking then? Some more new material, is that in the pipeline?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's fantastic. Yeah. Really exciting. We'll look forward to seeing that. Now, on the new record, The Cage, or the EP, obviously we're going to be expecting some great stuff from Billy and yourself, but just focusing on what you've added to this record, incredible playing as usual. Can we talk about the gear that you've been using on this? I'm assuming it's the Knaggs and the Friedman and the two notes and all that.
But
talk us through it.
Yeah, well, Knaggs is I have a history with the head of artist at Knaggs, Peter Wolf, because he was head of artist in Europe for Hamer Guitars way back.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
If people remember back.
We'll be going back there.
I had those goofy-looking guitars, but it was the 80s, so everybody had goofy-looking guitars.
Iconic, man. It's iconic stuff.
So Peter contacted me, and I had one really, really great PRS guitar, a McCarty, and Peter... sent me an email. I said, that guitar that you really like? Well, Joe Knaggs built that guitar. He was at the custom shop at PRS. Mm-hmm. He's got his own company now. We'd like to send you a guitar. And sure, send it. It wasn't exactly what I wanted. And I said, it's good, but if I had a guitar. And he said, well, we'll build you anything, And I went, really? You anything? And there were quite drastic things that I requested, and there was not at any point where they said, we can't do that, or we're afraid to do that, or whatever. So basically, I had this incredible handcrafted workshop, ultimate guitar workshop to build anything that I could think of. And so here we are, 10 years later, and I love the fact that they're a small company. There's only like 15 guys that work there. If I have a question about electronics or whatever, I get the guy on the phone. I know who he is. I've met him. Same with Friedman. I've worked with Dave for 24 years now, Dave Friedman. And originally he was just modding my amps, and then he went to Blankenship and modded an amp there, and then went off on his own. And I just follow Dave. I go, okay, what do you got? I trust the guy so much that if he suggests something, he knows what I like. I mean, I used to bring out these, vintage old Plexi Marshalls that are not really roadworthy. And so I said, basically, that's my sound. You know what I go for, and what my ear wants to hear. Mm-hmm. And we build upon that, and just so the fact is that, I don't care whose name is on the guitar or the amplifier. I would use it anyway. If people like what I do or like the sounds I go for, then that's cool. But it's not, we're not. It's not about an ego thing to have my name on the gear.
The sound and the feel that you.
I just want the tools that I need.
And that's why it's really interesting that you get the Two Notes thing. Of course, you get the new Platinum Collection when you've been doing the stuff with Two Notes for a while. But with some people. Not so much Two Notes, more like sometimes some of the stuff that's emulating amplifiers and all that sort of stuff. People don't feel like it feels as great. You might get a great sound going out there through the PA to the audience, but that feel can be a little bit different. With a player like yourself, where so much of it is on that feel of the instrument and the expression, was there ever any element of that with Two Notes?
Still essentially I'm using two amplifiers. I can turn them up to volumes where I never could before on stage because you get the bleed through the vocal mics, and then I had the issue where on previous tours I would put my cabinets off stage and cover them in blankets. They'd get moved. Phase issues. I've always used stereo setup, and it was every night was a little bit different and inconsistent. And the fact that, I said, well, I'll try the impulse response thing. It's going to be the same every night. And I can emulate microphones and speakers and setups that would be studio quality and bring them into the live setting. What we did is, and I was as skeptical as anybody. So what we did is we set it up. We set up at a venue. We set up the mic cabinets and the impulse responses. And I went out to the front of house and we A-B'd them. And it wasn't even close. I mean, and my front of house guy was very skeptical at that time. And we both went, it's not even a question. You know, pack the cabinets up. It's just, and I see more and more people are going this way.
It's incredible. I mean, because, you know, the truth of it is, I mean, a lot of people out there, they say with, you know, some of the Kemper stuff and what have you. I mean, it's a studio tool. Fantastic, you know, because you're going to tweak that and put it through desks and all sorts of shit before anyway. But in a live situation, I mean, there's no doubt that some of the bands that are out there taking that type of rig, they don't have that same power that they have when they've got what you've got on tour, you know.
Yeah, there's you know, there's something to be said about the way a tube amplifier breathes, the dynamics. You know, yes, you can emulate that with amplifier, you know, with digital and all of that. But I'm so old school, you know. You know, it's I just know how it feels under your fingers with an actual amplifier up there, and they kind of amplifiers sound different an hour into the show, so. It's kind of when you get to the beginning of that encore or whatever, the amp is really cooking and it's really saturated, and it's something to look forward to. And we actually, you know, as our set builds, when we get about three quarters of the way through, we're full throttle. We're not, there's no ballads at that point. We're, you know, Blue That's Highway, awesome. Rebel Yell, all the, you know, and the amp is reacting to that, and it's giving you everything that you need. I don't know if I'd get that from a modeled situation, because it would be the same the whole way through.
It's such an interesting angle to take with it, you know, because, you know, the combo as well. I mean, I've heard you talk in the past about how, you know, sometimes some chambered guitars, you wouldn't want to take them out because the volume that you guys play at, you're going to be getting feedback issues and what have you. But these days, with fewer and fewer people taking their stuff on the road and getting the opportunity to play on big stages, you know, it's such a unique position that you're in where you can be on stage with an amp really cooking, with a solid body, you know, a Les Paul or something like that, one of these really super heavy ones. But that special sweet spot of having that combo, that's where it comes to life.
Yeah,
at 10,
I'll
you
tell
know?
You what's really, because we're all on in-ears, what I've discovered is I've got a couple of guitars that have sustainiacs built into them. And that's really, you know, because people go, well, don't you miss the feedback? Well, that's one way to get around it. It's worked really well for me, so... Yeah,
that's killer. Now with the Knaggs stuff, I mean, we touched on it a little bit. Obviously, we've got iconic videos with you and records with you playing Hamer, and you picked up a Jackson from time to time. I'm sure we've seen you with a Les Paul in your hand many times. Yeah. So what did you take from all those experiences into that Knaggs, you know, deliberation of what was going to be the, because it was so much experience, what were the things that you really knuckled down that this is what it's got to be?
I had, you know, before hooking up with Knaggs, I had one Gibson reissue of 59 Black Beauty, and it had a big old chunky neck on it. And I sort of came to the realization that's part of the sound of the guitar, of an electric guitar, really is in that neck. I always found that those really skinny neck guitars sounded skinny to me. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the you know, you're fretting a note, it's vibrating on the on, you know, even fret material can make a difference in the sound. And then if you've got that classic kind of 59, a little bit of, you know, my guitars don't have like a baseball bat neck, but they're pretty hefty. Because I would say, you know, 80% of my time with playing Billy Idol stuff is a lot of rhythm guitar stuff.
Sure.
So I need that chunk factor. So we kind of, you know, that was one of the things that I was adamant about. Let's have a good chunky neck on there. The pickups actually are Bare Knuckles, sure. And I sought out Tim from Bare Knuckles. God, it's been...
That's a long relationship now, isn't it?
Yeah, and I just... I found him was just through an article, and I went and looked, and he was in an Aussie cover band, and he's a shit-hot guitar player, and I said, well, that guy's really good. And if he builds pickups, he's going to know what's good. And I met him, and I thought, he's a lovely guy. And I just went, you know, he sent me the Mule, which was the first one. And then we did a variation on that, which is the Rebel Yell.
Rebel Yell's got to be, it's got to be one of the older signature ones.
It's got like a bit more mid-range, like a certain pickup that was made in the 80s I used to use. And so I've been really happy with that. And once again, the same thing like Knaggs. I trust Tim, and, you know, sometimes guitars require different pickups. And I say, this is what the guitar is going to be. This is what it, you know, and he'll come up with something. Or we'll do trial and error, which is what we did with the Rebel Yell. I think it went through six different iterations before we settled on, okay, that's the right winding, right magnet, right amount of windings. And Tim supplies us with potentiometers now and all this stuff. And so I think that's, you know, as far as what's on the guitar. One of the things that Knaggs had avoided doing until I came into the picture was the angle of the headstock, because a lot of manufacturers are reticent about doing that, because if you drop the guitar, the head's, you know, that break angle, that's what Les Pauls are known for. And I said, I need that string tension. It does make a big difference. Mm-hmm. And I said, look, we have to do it that way. I'm not interested in the guitar unless we do that. And so far, you know, I said, look, these are not cheap instruments. I know with my instruments, I don't leave them unattended. I'm really careful with them. So, you know, if it falls over or whatever and breaks, hey man, you know, you should have guarded that a little bit more carefully. But it does play an important part in the feel and the sound of the guitar, that string tension.
And it all obviously sounds incredible. What for you, Steve, like, where does music begin for you? Like, even before guitar, like, what's your sort of earliest memories of being moved by music?
Wow, dating myself here, but, you know, it was, you know, at the time of the British invasion, the Beatles, the world was guitar crazy. Everybody had to have a guitar, and not only because of rock and roll bands, but also the folk protest music. And in the area I grew up in, Rockaway, there was a protest musician named Phil Oakes. And his sister was my first guitar teacher. My dad, actually, I was about 7 and a half. My dad brought home a guitar, paid $15 for it. Came with a little music book. It was a piece of crap. He was going to learn, but, you know, by the time he got home, had his dinner, he was a hard-working blue-collar. He was a printer. He didn't have the energy to. So the guitar ended up in my room, and I was banging away on it, and. And I have an older brother, 5 years older, and his friends played guitar. And they came over and they said, he's making a hell of a racket on it, but it's in time. So they knew I had rhythm.
Wow, okay.
So, you know, my parents said, oh, well, you know, we'll find somebody to give you guitar lessons. And that was Phil Oak's sister. And I started on folk guitar, on a nylon guitar, and then I met my first really important teacher, was a flamenco guitarist. That's how my love of flamenco came to be. And then when I was 13, I got my first electric guitar. And but up until that time, the you know, it was all on a nylon string guitar. So the stuff that I could play was Beatles, or The Who was great because Pete always had good acoustic. You know, I remember playing Pinball Wizard and all this stuff that you could emulate on an acoustic, whereas playing Foxy Lady didn't really sound right, you know, on a nylon. So when I was 13, I dove headfirst into, you know, the existing Led Zeppelin and all that. And then, you know, because I had a background in playing acoustic, when I first heard some of the progressive rock guitarists, like Steve Howe and Steve Hackett, it kind of clicked for me that I could take all of these styles and do them in a band. That was kind of, I was very, very much into that kind of thing. And then, you know, little by little, You know, I went to the High School of Performing Arts in New York, the Fame School, and then that was my introduction into Manhattan, and that's just about the time when CBGB's was happening.
Sure, yeah.
And then Robert Fripp moved to New York and befriended Chris Stein from Blondie, and it was that was important because there was a link to the Prague guy and what we called New Wave, or it was kind of, it was after the Ramones, but, and I went, ah, you can still be creative and do creative things on the guitar, like Tom Verlaine from Television, and then Billy Idol, you know, turned me on to guys like John McGeehutt and some of the more experimental guys that were like part of the punk thing. And and to me, it's always been, it's all about music, and it's all, you know, it's all about taking some of your influences and also listening to things outside of what you play.
Yeah.
I don't listen to a lot of guitarists. I listen to a lot of, you know, film scores and things because they really help me understand arranging and things like that, things I can apply to songwriting.
Of course.
So that's...
Well, when you think about it at the time, you know, like, obviously with Generation X being more of, you know, that typical punk style, and then, you know, you're bringing all that element into it, you know, to create, basically when you guys got together, it created a whole new thing that had, you know, just you know, it's like a whole new meal you know, in a sense, you know, with that. But what I wanted to know with that inspiration that you had as a player and for music, has that always been a through line for you in terms of your writing, like to trust your instinct in terms of the way the music sort of moves you, or when it comes to solo writing or songwriting, is it still relate back to how you were moved by someone like Steve Howe or you know, Mick Ronson or these guys?
Yeah. Well, it's, you know, it's always, for me, it's always been about the song, and I never waited for the glory of the solo. Like here's my, you know,
yeah.
I think it was instilled in me to contribute and be a collaborator, because making music, you know, and being in a band is really about having a conversation. But also when you work with someone, like when I first met Billy, I had a guy who had a direction. I had been in bands before. I'd recorded with bands before, but it never really happened because there was no direction. There was no style. There was nothing that had, you know, a touch, taste, and an identifiable thing. And I thought, wow, I can. Here's something I can build on.
Yeah.
Here's a guy who, you know, has a career and knows what he wants to do. And he had already formed an alliance with Keith Forsey, the producer. Now Keith came from the Giorgio Moroder scene and done disco records, Donna Summers, and things like that. And I thought, well, that's really cool because he's willing to work with people outside of. He's not just working with a guy who does punk rock records. And I remember saying to Billy, I said, you know, I'm not a guy who came from a punk rock band, but anything, I can guarantee you this, anything you could think of musically in your head, I'll be able to give it to you, rather than you having to have a guy that you have to push all the time, or you have to, you know, you have to reach a limit. Or I said, any idea, if you want to do reggae, if you want to add, you know, ska, or, you know, or dub things, I'm into it. You know, I understand effects. And the other thing was that on the third, you know, by the third Generation X record, there were some experimental things. And I said, oh, you know, if you're willing to go, if you naturally want to go down that kind of road,
let's go all that.
That's great. Mm-hmm. I loved all of the stuff he had done. I loved, you know, Generation X. And I said, you know, if we can harness that punk rock energy and way heyness of Steve Jones and those guys, because to me Jonesy was a lot like one of my guys, you know, New York guys, was Johnny Thunders. And I thought, yeah, I get that, you know, we've got that too in New, you know, in New York. So I think we just met at common ground and then expanded on it.
No, absolutely. I mean, to fast forward a little bit, because incredibly there's not actually that many years in it. Looking back on it now, you know, it feels like it would be. But once you get to Atomic Playboys, and the incredible record, this, I think one of the more underrated rock albums of the last 30, well, So over 30 years now. Yeah. But just the title track itself, I mean, man, when that intro kicks in all the way, I mean, and then the solo, I mean, there's so much I could embarrass myself on. I love the track so much. But how does that end up not being a Billy Idol track?
I think they were just like stylized things. I remember actually we were on the tour bus on the Whiplash Smile tour, and this compilation, we used to watch videos and things, and there was something about atomic bombs and things like that, and there was that footage of the generals who are detonating these atomic bombs out in the desert, and he goes, "We're not atomic playboys," and I went, "Ooh, that's a good title," and here we are. So many years later.
No one's doing that now, are they?
It's still we're worrying about who's going to detonate a nuke. And what I did, you know, it was kind of one of the factors why Billy and I didn't work together at that time was he moved to Los Angeles and I wanted to stay in New York. Mm. And I was also courted by Warner Brothers, by Ten Templeman, who was the producer. He was the A&R guy at Warner's, but also producer of Van Halen and Dewey Brothers, and I thought, wow, this is a guy I really would love to work with. And, you know, I went to Billy and I said, look, I'm not going to move to Los Angeles, we'll have to, reconvene at some, down the line. But it was never anything like, fuck you, or any, it was not, it was like, good luck to both, good luck, man, I'll see you down the road. There was no personal things involved, we were just, moving in different directions.
So none of that was written then? All of the album was written post?
It was, yeah.
So we're just taking some of the influences from that and...
Absolutely. Yeah. Of course, the track Crackdown, I always imagined Billy singing that. It was written in my head like thinking, wow, that's the one song I thought, that's a shame it's not a Billy Idol song.
Yeah, because we know we're not going to see this music live again, in that form with that band, because I know you've said in the past it was a bit of an expensive hobby for you, to take that out and do
it
that.
Was,
but
it was.
But surely some of these tracks could make their way into that, especially Atomic Playboys being so relevant these days. Is there ever the talk about squeezing some of these into the set?
Not in a Billy Idol set, but I did do a solo tour about 4 years ago, and I brought out some of those tunes. And Frankie Perez was the singer with us. He's in Apocalyptica. And the reaction from the audience was great, because I didn't know. I just thought, let's throw in a couple of... We did Crackdown, and we did Atomic Playboys, and the audience was like... Yeah. It was great. And so there's some, I'm not against, in the context of a solo band of doing that stuff, there are some really good tunes. What I like about that record is that it's not all ooh, love you baby type music.
No.
I've got a song about James Brown being incarcerated. So there's some, I didn't want to do the typical, L.A. glam type thing, but it's definitely a shreddy guitar record.
Well, what's cool as well, the three solo records, they're very varied, obviously. There's a very, very different music on each, and for anyone who's not checked them out, 100% should be on their playlist, that's for sure.
Awesome.
Especially these days, it used to be hard to get a hold of some of these records.
Right,
But it's all on streaming. Just to go back in time again a little bit, because it wouldn't be right in 2022 it being 40 years since that debut record, the self-titled, and then of course going straight into Rebel Yell. What are your sort of reflections on those days in the studio putting that together? Did you feel that these records were going to be as big as they are?
No, I mean, we never really thought in those terms, especially on the first record, because I really had no proper experience in the studio. And it was my first experience in Los Angeles. We recorded the first album in L.A. Actually, at Westlake Studios, down the hall from Michael Jackson was doing, I believe he was working on Thriller at that time.
Yeah.
So I was just really fortunate that I had Keith Forsey as the producer, because in a lot of times, you know, in some situations, I wouldn't know how to get a guitar sound, or there were things that were called on, like a clean Strat thing, and that wasn't my wheelhouse.
Yeah, yeah.
And Keith said he never brought in session guys afterwards. You know, I'll wait till Steve leaves. And he always gave me the chance to discover it and do it myself. And he had a lot of patience. So I was very fortunate to work with guys who were willing to work with me. And my attitude was always, especially on the first record, my attitude was always to say, it was okay to say, I don't know, you know,
sure.
I don't know how to do that, or can you help me, or help, you know, with the engineer. And I always tell musicians, it's okay not to know everything.
Yeah.
Because you won't know how to do something unless you screw it up the first time. That's how you learn. You go, all right, I won't do it that way again. Now I know how to do it. But by the time we came to Rebel Yell, it was no question that A, we had the songs, and B, we were recording in New York, and we were recording at Electric Lady Studios, the studio Jimi Hendrix built. So, man, sometimes just all of the things align, the stars align, and we found the killer drummer in Tommy Price. And all I had to do was kind of get out of my own way.
Yeah.
You know, we had great songs, so if I didn't screw it up, they were going to be great. It was going to be a great record. So, you know, it was just a matter of really just documenting it.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't have to fix anything, as the tracks were coming together, even, you know, we take home rough mixes, and I was like, you could release that. I remember saying, you could just release that rough mix.
Yeah, you were just in that zone at that time. Yeah,
fantastic.
Fantastic. Was there anything that never got released that
not really, no. There were tunes that we, because we did proper pre-production, and there were tunes and ideas that were left at the wayside during pre-production, because the cream rises to the top.
Of course, of course, and there's a lot of cream on those records, that's for sure, as there is on all of your records. Now, the Michael Jackson situation on Bad and Dirty Diana, how did that come to be?
Again, Ted Templeman was, you know, he was really in my corner, and he was friends with Quincy Jones. So I guess the story I got from Ted was that Quincy called him and said, we're doing the follow-up album to Thriller. Yeah. And we've got another rock track, and who do you suggest? And I had just signed with Warners, and Ted said, yeah, you got to give Steve Stevens a call, and Billy. Yeah. And I guess Quincy went, oh, yeah, because by then Rebel Yell had become successful, and he went, oh, yeah, that guy will be good.
Yeah.
It was as simple as that.
Good experience?
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And you know, I'm not a session guitar player. I never was. People hired me to do bring a specific thing, and but I was very nervous, thinking, oh, there's going to be this massive entourage, and the monkey will be there, you know, all this stuff you heard about, and I thought, wow, you know, because I'm only used to working with me and Billy and Keith and an engineer. We keep it small.
Yeah.
And I opened the studio door when I got there, and it was Michael, Quincy, and the engineer, and I was like, oh, I feel at home. This is the way we work, and very intimate, very cool and cordial, and Michael was very musical. And being that I really don't read music, well, neither does he. So he just conveyed, you know, some ideas to me verbally, you know, scat things. And then I was, you know,
was the track finished at that point? Was it were you
the
just
backing track? Was, the backing track was. So it was just a matter of covering what they needed first, and then they said, now go in and do what you would want to do.
Yeah.
And inevitably, that's what ended up.
Yeah, because, I mean, you always elevate tracks when you have the solo sections, but it's such a vibe, that solo. I mean, even, you know, to this day, you know, the sonic sort of wall that you create, and of course, you've got the gun in there as well.
Yeah, Michael loved that, because he's a science fiction guy, you know. He was like, how do you do that?
Yeah.
I was like, oh, yeah, I'll show you. Come in, you know. It was great.
And just before we let you go, because we know you've got to get ready for the show, but I heard the rumor that with the Top Gun theme, that apparently that was supposed to be for another film, and Billy is overheard it through a wall. Or can you clear this up? What is the story behind this track?
So I wasn't there when this happened, but from what I understand, Harold Faltermeyer, who composed and scored Top Gun, came in as the keyboard player on Whiplash Smile because he had worked with Keith Forsey in Germany with Giorgio. So Harold's working on the stuff, you know, on Whiplash Smile, and then during his during the downtime after our session, he was working on Top Gun, and I guess he had the theme or something, and it was originally a little piece that Billy heard, which was slated for. I could get this wrong, but maybe a Chevy Chase
I've
movie.
Heard that, yeah.
I don't know if it was Fletch or something.
Oh, right, yeah.
Another film that Harold was getting ready to do. And Billy said, there's your Top Gun theme. And Harold, it was right under Harold's nose, and he did. He went, oh, okay. And I'm as blind to it as you are. That's the story I heard.
And then it was like, right, come in, and you play the guitar, like, right off the bat.
Basically, yeah. A week later, Harold asked me to play guitar on it, and we switched over the multi-track.
Yeah.
After the same thing, after the, you know, it was about 9 o'clock at night after the idle session. And I think the whole thing took us a couple of hours to do.
Amazing.
Because I was already, all my gear was already set up, so it was just a matter of playing that incredible melody, you know, Harold's. I mean, there's nobody who does that like Harold Faltermeyer.
And it's still going these days, you know, right to today, you know, it's still relevant. But look, Steve, absolute pleasure to chat with you. Thanks for taking some time out today.
Yeah,
and I can't
wait
to see the show tonight.
Great. Awesome. Me too. Cheers. Thank you.